Hi, this is Von Glitschka from Glitschka Studios, and I wanted to take you through kind of a real-world creative process. Specifically, this is going to take you through a branding project I worked on for a technology called Suricata. Now, the reason why I'm doing this is instead of just showing you how Astute Graphic plugins work, they have people on staff at Astute Graphics that can do that far better than I ever could. So I didn't want to do that. That's not my strong suit. My strong suit is my work. It's my design, both illustration and graphic design. In this case, this is a good example of illustrative design. I'm using illustrative methodology within the context of a branding project, and I want to show you how Astute Graphics plugins actively play a part in how I create my vector artwork, and it makes it easier, faster, more precise, and it's a whole lot of fun. So I want to show you exactly how I use them at each different stage and how they play a part. Some of it is expected. Some of it is something I've discovered how to use them in a way that they don't really market it that way, but it works really great that way. And you're going to see that coming up here shortly. So when I'm working on a project like this for a brand, I'll explore all the various typefaces I could use on this. Since it's technology, I wanted it simplified, clean, aesthetic, very kind of Spartan, but with enough characteristics to work well for a logo type. So this is how I explore with photography. This is usually where I start. I'll throw it on one layer, and then I'll pick and choose, and you'll see which one I kind of move forward with as we go along. Now, when it comes to the brand mark, the actual vector artwork I need to create, it all starts in analog. In my book, Vector Basic Training, I really go over intensely the creative process from analog to digital. And once you've worked out your design in a drawn form, I really strongly believe you should know what you're going to create before you create it, rather than just noodling out of thin air. More efficient, you're going to get better work when it's all said and done. I start in the drawn phase. So this is my drawn iconography, and the character they wanted to represent the technology Suricata. Actually, the name Suricata is a variant of the species of meerkat. Meerkat is like an animal. Think of a prairie dog, but a lot longer neck and smaller head and a bigger snout. Anyway, that character represents this technology, and its name is a Suricata. And so that's the name they gave this technology, and they wanted the brand mark to reflect that. So I'm working off of real world references and then iconifying and simplifying them down and condensing it to the raw essence to create this brand mark. This is going to be a symmetrical brand mark. And it's at this phase that I'll scan my drawing in. I usually set the layer to about 15% and I lock it. Guides in Illustrator are considered objects, so I isolate them all to a guides layer because that way I can control them and they don't get embedded into my art. It's a good habit to get into. Otherwise, if they get embedded into the art or a group, it can cause problems. You can always go to view and go to guides and clear guides if you have that problem, and wherever they are within your art, it'll resolve that problem. But to avoid it, I put all my guides on their own layer. That way I can kind of manage them easier. So on a layer called build, this is where I'll start vector building. So where do you begin vector building? Where do you put your first anchor point down? On a character like this, I usually start with the eyes. Now, I don't build at this size, meaning I don't build without being zoomed in. This is like sitting on the International Space Station. If you grab a pen tool and you're trying to build, well, you're not close enough to see what you're doing. So don't be afraid to zoom in. Zooming in is what you should do. So I'm going to zoom in on this eye. Now, I want to demonstrate first how you can do this in Adobe Illustrator out of the box without any plugins, even though this video is for Astute Graphics. I need to do this to show you why their plugin is so great. When you use the pin tool, if you double click the pin tool, nothing happens. That's because it's a one size fits all. That is, Adobe is saying, this is our pin tool, this is how it works, deal with it. You can't customize it. You can't adjust it to be as sensitive as you want. This is all you get, just deal with it. Okay, fine, we'll deal with it. Where do you start? Wherever your art comes to a point should get a point. So we'll start here. We'll go up here, 12 o'clock if you're using the clockwork method. Wherever it comes to a point gets a point here. We'll come down here. This is like a 6 o'clock, pull out the vector handles, and we'll end here. Now I forgot to set the graphic style, so we're going to be working with a magenta line. I usually like doing that just because it's easier to see on top of the grayed out drawing. But that's how you build if you're using the pen tool out of Adobe out of the box. Once you're done doing that, you're going to have to switch to another tool, the selection tool, and then you can grab the line. Once again, they kind of ripped this off of Astute Graphics, but they did a really poor job of being able to bend these segments, because as you grab this, yeah, you can bend it. But notice how it starts messing with the other segment right above it. Well, you can't. Well, let's go into this tool and adjust it. Oh, you can't go into that tool and adjust it either, because once again, Adobe says this is the way it works. Deal with it. And so to deal with it, you have to start messing with this. You pull it over to get that curve right. But all of a sudden now, once again, you have to switch to another selection tool. So that's the third tool on this object. And you find out that your anchor point's now broken. You go back to this one and you start adjusting this one. And yes, it'll bend the path, but you can see it's wonkifying the bottom part. And so you bring this up and all of a sudden, oh, you have another anchor point that's busted. So you can see how, can you build this with the existing tools in Illustrator? Yes. Is it easy? Is it intuitive? Does it make the process go faster? Absolutely not. And this is a very simple shape. If you have something far more complex than organic, it just compounds the problem. So don't use that tool. I suggest InkScribe. InkScribe's great because if we double click this, you can customize all the settings. You can tell it how you want it to behave, what you want it to do, what you want it to show you as you're working on it. So you can customize it. Here's all my customizations for this tool. We'll go back now and I'll use this tool to build the exact same shape. And I'm using the same methodology I use with the pen tool in Illustrator. But as you're going to see really quickly here, so this is my base raw vector artwork. Now, I don't have to switch tools. With this tool, I immediately get access to what are called ghost points. So you can see, or ghost handles, that is. You can see this ghost handle here. I can just grab that and immediately start adjusting it. I can grab this handle, pull it out. Notice the S shows up. That means, hey, we know you want this to be smooth. We're going to keep it smooth. We're not going to mess up your anchor point here. You can also go over the path, and this is using the other technology they have in their plugins, which is a separate plugin called VectorScribe, but it's part of InkScribe. So you can grab on a path and you can start pulling out. Notice how it lets me pull out my path, but now, oh, this is broken. Well, not really, because you once you pull this down, it's smart enough to know that should be smooth. The S shows up again, and you can see how this process just goes a lot faster. Not only faster, but it's just more precise. It just enables you to build artwork a lot easier, a lot more precisely. And notice, I never switched the tool. One tool, not three tools, one tool. And I did all the same stuff that Illustrator did. Now, not everything is plugin driven. So like on this eye, we'll build the eye shape. This is just using the ellipse tool. I have keyboard shortcuts set up, so I just clone that. There is no clone command in Illustrator, so that's just simply a recorded action applied to the F3 key. I'll F3 it again to make another clone, and I do that just because it speeds up the process. It enables for faster vector building. And this is just simple shape building methods to create all the elements in this eye that you can see here. And so if I zoom out, I now have my eye built. Now I'll create other aspects of this character, like the base of his body. Once again, I'm not even gonna bother going to the pen tool in Illustrator. We're just gonna stick with InkScribe. And because I have, this is where I'll use the space bar to move around. I'll stay at this zoom ratio, but I'll use the space bar to move my palette or my artboard around so I can start building. So when we start creating this, I'll put a point here. And I'm going to just focus on the shape, not the ear at this point, just the shape. And because I'm doing that, I will put one right about here because of the angle I'm creating. And then we'll put one right down about here. And this will be like a 9 o'clock. And then I want to go further out than I need to because I can always lop it off. And this is how I'll build this shape. And then it's just a matter of going back. And their head kind of comes to a pointed at the top and rounds out. So that's why I built that way. I'm being guided by actual nature. I'm just simplifying it into a very graphic form. So you can see how fast it is to build it. Now, you might have to go back in and adjust the position. So you'll get it in the right neighborhood, but maybe not the exact correct location. So always scrutinize where you place your anchor points. So this is how I start building my vector art. Now the nose of this character, this is where I'll use shape building again, because I can just use simple tools such as the ellipse tool to create the nose in this case. So those are easy. Those are like probably the easiest things to create. I'll do the same thing to create the nose. But on the ear character, it's the same type of thing. I'll start here. This will be like a 12 o'clock. And then I'm going to go all the way down to where I have this anchor point, snap to that, create that. And then this is where, oh, you can see right there, I accidentally, and I do this all the time because after years and years of using the pen tool, I do accidentally gravitate to the pen tool at times. So instead of using InkScribe, and it always like, oh, why'd I do that? I should have used InkScribe. So, but that's okay because we got VectorScribe here. This allows me to show you VectorScribe because you can just come over and you just pull out your anchor points. Once again, it has knows it's smart, so it knows you need that to be smooth, so it fixes that so you don't break your anchor points, that is. And on this one, we're going to pull this down and pull out the ghost handle. I love the name of ghost handles. I think that's just an awesome brand name, but I think the functionality is just genius, and it facilitates great vector building. So this just shows the base artwork I created. Now, like a good cooking show, I don't want to spend 2 hours going over this. Nobody wants to hear me talk for 2 hours, but we have some of this pre-baked. So we'll just go to the artwork. So you can see the same artwork, but this was all I created for my base vectors. You can see I have auto saver on. It just saved my file. That's another plugin by Astute Graphics, which is great. That's save my bacon more times than I can count. Illustrator crashed, but I had auto saver on, so I didn't lose anything. So that's a great plugin to get as well. So I have my base vector art. Because this is a symmetric design, the nose and mouth is already fully created. It's just a matter of taking this, I clone it. Once again, I'm using my F3 key. I go to the reflect tool, snap on the center point of the design somewhere, and then I can reflect it over to get my full vector design. Now, I already have this kind of fused together. Well, I should point that out. I just select these shapes and then go to Pathfinder, fuse them together into one unified shape. And that's all I've done with this next layer here. And I fused the head with the ears here, so you can see that, and just fuse those together as well. Oops, first thing you have to do, I need to clone the head. And then I would just cookie cutter, kind of punch out these shapes. Then I would go back in and I would fuse these together like that. And I do that on both sides, actually. So what I end up with is this. And now I'm pretty close to now being able to colorize my artwork. And it's at this point where I get all my base vectors established, all my base vectors worked out. This is where I start thinking about color. I don't really think about color until this stage because I'm focusing on shape and form. So this is where I establish I'm going to use this color palette for the brand colors. They had no established brand colors, but this is what I want to do. Now, there's a little bit of editing I need to do on this character. So we're going to snap, and this is a good thing to suggest. Smart Guides is great. It's important to have that on, but I want to warn you, it doesn't always snap to point. It's a bug in Illustrator. Illustrator has yet to fix it. So you just need to be aware of that and not fully trust it. Always check your work because you can trust it and come to find out an hour later after building for an hour that it didn't snap something. It can be very frustrating. So just be aware of that. So I'm going to create what I call throwaway shape, select this head and go back to Pathfinder and just trim off the bottom part, select these and make sure these guys are behind these shapes. Now I can start colorizing this. I'm going to colorize, and this is how I colorize. I'll actually make swatches like this, and then I'll just use the eyedropper tool, and then I'll just start painting using the eyedropper tool. This one, I'll just sample the background actually for white, and it defaults to the white here. And his eyes and his ears and his nose and his mouth, or maybe this is a girl, I don't know, guy, girl, doesn't matter, they all kind of look the same, meerkats that is. And you can see this character is now coming to life, and make these white as well. So that looks pretty good. Now, after I got this far, I decided he needs a little more to him. And that's where I decide, oh, I know what I'm going to do. So I'm going to snap to this point. And let's just color it so you can see what I'm doing. Go like that. We're going to select this shape. And I'm cloning this so it makes a copy of the shape. Select the rectangle we created. We'll go to Pathfinder. We'll do this, we'll go to the eyedropper, we'll sample this tint. This is a 15% tint. If I go to color, 15% tint of this kind of turquoise type color. We'll select the body. And we're gonna make sure, paste right behind. So this is the brand mark now. So it's getting there. I think this is looking really good. Now, one thing that I'll do on a brand mark like this is because this is blue, what happens at times is when you go to print, because there's blue right on the edge where this is white, you'll see a thin hairline sometimes. So this is how I deal with this. Once again, some of this doesn't have anything to do with plugins. I'm going to show you how I use the next plugin very shortly, so just bear with me. But I'll do this just to make sure that where this blue hits the artwork, it's never going to have an opportunity to create a hairline there because I'm adjusting the path, and that's usually what I do. Anyway, I just wanted to point that out. Now, as much as I like the way this artwork's looking, vector art at times has or runs the risk of looking too computer generated, too perfect, and too sharp. So I like to go to the rounding tool, the dynamic corner tool by Astute Graphics, and that can be seen here. By the way, you can go to Windows and you can go down to VectorScribe and you can open up the dynamic corners panel, and so you can have that open if you want. I don't have it open right now, but that's how you do that. And you just select any shape. So we're going to select this shape. We're going to take the rounding tool, and we want to keep it on true radius. True radius is it'll create perfect circular curves. If I had it on standard, it would take the angles of the vector paths that exist on the shape and make the round align with those geometries. But in this case, I want true radius. And so this is where I think we need to zoom in even further, because these are very subtle rounds. So I'll go in on a shape like this, and we obviously don't want to round it that much. That's like a preview of where it is right now, 24 point whatever points up here. So we're going to click on this corner. We're just going to pull it out just so it's ever so slightly rounded. Once we've done one, we can just click the next one. It applies the exact same roundness. So if I deselect this, and we go to a different shape, you can see how it's added those nice little rounds there. And I like doing this on my logo art because it buttons up the artwork. It makes it look more hand quality. Now, another feature that I use a lot, and once again, we're going to have to go down and open up, let's see, we're going to open up the PathScribe palette, and we'll move this down here. Fuse it to the bottom there. Now on this shape that I created for the eye, you can see that I have these anchor points because of the way I built it with shape building. One nice feature in PathScribe, and it's a great feature because I use it all the time. You're going to see how I use it in a unique way coming up really soon. But I'll go over here to the palette for PathScribe, and this is Smart Remove. Watch what happens when I Smart Remove it. Nothing. It just removes them and it retains the art beautifully. It doesn't screw up my vector art, hence smart. It removes them smartly. If I Command Z this and we go back to these and I select them, there's no way of doing this in Illustrator. You can only do this with the plugins. If I go up to Illustrator's methods, this is remove anchor point tool, and I click on it, that's what you get. So it's a no-brainer to use Smart Remove because it doesn't destroy your art. It allows you to clean up artwork like that and do it really well. If you use the Width tool in Illustrator, it can create an absurd amount of anchor points, and in which case, under VectorScribe, you can Smart Remove using the Smart Remove brush tool. So that's a great feature as well. So you might want to check that out on their site. So I'll go in on this artwork and I'll round off all the various corners. I'll go in on this here and do it. The part on the ear I want to do is right here. I want to round that. I'll go down to the nose. I'll round these corners on the nose and on the mouth. So I'll do that all throughout my artwork until what I end up with is this is everything rounded off, including the rectangle here. Now, one thing I should point out is if I select this art, go back to my rounding tool, you can see how it's showing all of these corners that are rounded, and I can go back in and unround them. So I don't want to destroy this art, but I will demo this one thing because it's pretty cool. And I use this literally all the time in order to facilitate, especially iconography and logo design. So if I round this, I can go in, round it either way, and you can see how useful this tool is. Now, does Illustrator have a rounding ability like this? Yes. But you can notice none of Illustrator's rounding controls are showing up. Why is that? It's because I actively kind of hide them. There's no way to turn them completely off. But if you go to preferences, and I think they're in smart guides. Nope, they are in selection anchor display. Yeah, here they are. Hide corner widget for angles greater than. The default here is high when you first open Illustrator, so they'll show up on every object. I put it at 3% so that they never show up because I never use it because they get in the way. If you go to select an anchor point and you're not really zoomed in, you'll grab their stupid corner controls and it really screws up the process. Astute Graphics or rounding plugin is just a no-brainer, easy to use, very intuitive, does not get in the way. That's the biggest thing for me. I don't want it to obscure my process. And Adobe's methodology is, once again, a one size fits all. You can't adjust it or control the settings, but on the rounding tool, you get all kinds of controls within its own palette and how to handle that. You also get a control of preferences, and you can tell it exactly how you want it to function. So it gives you all the controls that a pro user should have that Adobe kind of play schools with their plugins, and that can be problematic at times. So this logo was now ready for me to present. This was the logo I sent to the client and presented it to him. He liked it, but then he came back and he said, I want the byline to be different. So we changed the byline to advanced detection and monitoring. Now, when he did that, I decided to enhance the logo mark to kind of conceptually play off of the functionality of what this coding language was all about. And that is detection and monitoring of servers to prevent nefarious things from happening. And so I created kind of a barrier motif around the character in the brand mark. And I really like that. Now, whenever I'm looking at something, the client loved this, by the way, he approved it. And as far as that was concerned, everything was done. But I don't care if a client likes something. If something's bugging me, I need to figure out why. And when I looked at this mark and scrutinized it, and this is where self-art directing yourself is so very important. I looked at this, something was bugging me about it. And then it hit me. The part that was bugging me was the convergence, and I'm going to go to keyline view, of all these shapes here where I'm circling. And it was bugging me because it wasn't handled elegantly. In my book, I cover something called visual tension. This has visual tension. Not only that, it has this kind of strange little indentation, which I really don't want. I want a nice, elegant flow on the side down into the neck. Not only that, the more I looked at this character, the more I realized after scrutinizing real-world reference material that its head was a little too fat at the bottom and base of the neck, and it could be improved upon. So this is where I wanted to set forth and improve this even further. The client liked it. He approved it. It was ready to go. But I don't care if he approved it and thought it was ready to go. I think I could make it better. So I spent more time to make it better, to improve the clarity of the mark. So I went back to my base vectors. I don't want to deal with color. I just want to concentrate on form. So I kind of revert to that. Now, one thing I had done is on my base vectors, you know, I still have the rounds on them. So if I go to the corner tool, you can see it's the rounding is still there. I don't need to touch the eye, nose, or mouth. Those are fine. I will be adjusting this ear, so I want to remove the round on the ear. And this is why this tool, the rounding tool, is so great. It's dynamic, meaning I can go back and I can remove it by just dragging it out, and now I don't have the round on it anymore. And that's what I need to do, because I need to adjust this. I need to fix this art. I'm going to get rid of this shape, which is the shading shape. And I'm just going to focus on the right side of this body, because I'm going to make some adjustments now. And those adjustments are to improve the form, to improve the shape of my character. And what I'm going to do is I want the edge of this to really kind of flow better. And if I select this anchor point, this is where another approach that I'll do really, really helps. I'll go in when I know I'm going to make an edit here, and I'll add an anchor point right at, in this case, right at the apex of where 3 o'clock would be if you're thinking the clockwork method, and I'll add an anchor point there. Now I'll go back in, I'll select this anchor point, and you can see now this is a corner anchor point. it's not a smooth one. That's why we got that indentation there. And it was purposeful because of the way I did the ear, but I wanted to improve it. I wanted to make it better. So this is where I'll use the Smart Remove. And it's something I discovered as a way of building, because if I remove this, it kind of does the math for me. It figures out how to make that curve elegant. And I go, that's it. That's closer to what I really want. So all I have to do now is just adjust my handles in order to add a nice kind of elegance to the detailing here. Now, once again, I wanted to keep a nice space going here with the inside of the ear. And so this allowed me, by using the plugins, it just allowed me to do this relatively easily. I didn't have to do a hot, I think this one needs to come out a little farther. So let me zoom in. I'm usually not talking as I'm building. So, oh, actually, I just realized I should do something. I'm going to add a 12 a point here. And once again, I'll go back in, I'll smart remove this. And so you can see how it kind of facilitates your building. Once again, if you're using the clockwork method, and then on this, I'll just pull this out. I think that'll look better. Just this a little more. Yeah, I think that spacing looks a lot better now. And maybe pull this in a little bit. And I think that looks a lot better. So if we compare the right side to the left side, this didn't look bad in the coloring. I just think this is going to look a lot better in the coloring over here. So I'll also go in with the smart tool, pick up the characteristic by just clicking this, and then I'm going to apply it to the bottom of the ear here. That's another thing with the rounding tool that you can't do with Adobe's tools. You can almost like copy an attribute and apply it to another one. I use that all the time as well. So you can see how I've improved this ear. And once again, I'll bring in the branding colors here and I'll color out this so that what I end up with is, you can see the one on the left, let me collapse these. The one on the left is the original. Not only is the ears kind of hinky, you can see on the right how I improved the clarity of the overall brand mark by making those adjustments. I use Smart Remove, just a small little sub feature of a incredible plugin, but it facilitates my vector building. It makes it better. It makes it easier to pull off. I'm not playing around with handlebars. It's really smart and intuitive in how it works. I used a rounding tool to finesse my art and to get it to looking really great. And on this case, I actually changed the branding to be more of a blue hue rather than the turquoise. I think that works better. So when it's all said and done, the finalized brand mark looks like this. The client loved it. I even took the time to explain that I went in and fixed that. And he appreciated that because he actually came back and said, well, you know what? That's what we do all the time as coding. We're always going back and improving things until we get it to work the way we need it. So he kind of appreciated that. Now, I like to present what I call brand systems. So in terms of what I provide to the client, they get a horizontal, a vertical, and a secondary brand graphic, which is kind of this badge design. Now, this is the technology for this security kind of detection system, but he's developing a whole nother proprietary piece of software that plays off of this technology. Now, when more than one Miracat or Siricata get together, it's called a mob. So I branded another kind of an analytics basis to work with this technology. So it gives reporting, and this utilizes multiple facets of Siricata, hence the mob analogy. And then he called it Mobster. So it's more than one of these Siricata. So that's how I approach brand design. That's how I build my artwork from the very basis of a drawing, how I build the base vector artwork, how I finesse it utilizing InkScribe, VectorScribe, the dynamic corners tool, Smart Remove. I use some of the other features as well by Astute on different projects, but those are the bread and butter ones I use day in and day out, and it allows me to not only create precisely, but work a lot easier and a lot less frustration in the build process. So I highly encourage you to check out all of Astute's plugins. And if you buy my book, Vector Basic Training, up until January, actually the end of December of this year, you will also be able to get a 10% discount of all their plugins. So check out Astute Graphics. They're an absolutely spot-on developer. They're always improving their tools. They don't just develop them, release them, and forget about them. They continually improve and continually make them better. So it's a great company. It facilitates great vector building experience, and it will facilitate your design as well. So I hope you've enjoyed this video and it helps you to see how I create and possibly how you can use these plugins to create better artwork yourself.